start with a question. What are you afraid of? What are you afraid of? Snakes. That's an excellent. They are worthy of being afraid of. Anybody else? Spiders? Is that okay? So those are the main two things that people tend to be afraid of: snakes and spiders. If you ask my wife, it's bugs in general. She believes that they are plotting against her at all points of time, and it's a lot of fun living in the country with that. But we are all scared of something, and if you go through and find what the top 10 things that people are afraid of, number one, of course, is public speaking. That is most people's main fear, but the second one may surprise you. The second one is actually loneliness. Loneliness. People are afraid of being alone. And I know most of us can attribute to that in some way or another. Personally, I really enjoy spending time by myself. You talk to any mother, boy, the one thing that they crave is time alone. But there is such a thing as too much time alone, isn't there? See, one summer I was in between jobs, and I was in between years of university, and I was living at home for just a little bit. My parents had moved to a brand new city that I didn't really know. And so I was there at that city, and I didn't really know anybody. I didn't really want to build any relationships because I knew I was only going to be there for a little while. I had no plans of staying there. I had no plans of coming back to really put down any roots there of any kind. And so I thought, well, I'm not going to invest a lot of time into building friendships because I'm just not going to be here that long. And so I had some time on my hands, and I didn't want to impose on Mom and Dad too much. So I committed myself to going to see every single movie that came out that summer. And I said, it didn't matter what it is, I'm just going to go see it. Because there was this little theater that they waited until the movies were a couple weeks old or a month old or whatnot. And you could buy a ticket for like $2. And I thought, no problem, that'll kill some time. And so I started going to see all these movies, and I went by myself to these movies. Has anyone ever done that before? Have you ever gone to a movie by yourself? It's kind of odd because people, I actually heard this once, somebody sitting behind me was betting on whether or not I was there on a date. It was just kind of weird to hear what people thought as you're sitting there by yourself, and then the movie's up, you just kind of leave, and there's no one really to discuss it with. And after a few months, it started getting a little odd. And then this happened. This particular movie came out. Have you seen it? I had committed myself to a course of seeing every movie that came out that summer. And this was the last one. This is starring Lindsay Lohan, and it was targeting 14-year-old girls. That's what this movie was for. And I went to see it. I went and I got in line, and you know, there was a bunch of teenagers and young teens in front of me with their moms or older sister or friend or whoever, you know, and they are all buying tickets in groups. And then I got up to the counter and I was like, I'd like a ticket, please. For which movie? For Mean Girls. Oh, how many tickets would you like? Because everybody sit before me, you know, big groups. And I kind of looked around and I said, one. The girl behind the counter, I kid you not, she did this. She went, and she made that noise. You see, sometimes we're not supposed to do certain things alone. And a young man going to a movie for teenage girls is certainly one of those. It turned out not to be that bad of a movie, actually, but that's besides the point. Certain things we're not supposed to do alone. In fact, in Britain, in 2017, they realized that loneliness was such an issue in our society, being alone was such a problem, that they opened up an entire ministry to tackle the problem, the Ministry of Loneliness. Now, how would you like to have that title? I'm the Minister of Loneliness as your name tag, right? But this is a real issue that needs to be addressed because something inside of us, even those of us who like to spend time by yourself, all of us need more than just ourselves. All of us need some sort of connection, some sort of community around us. And it turns out that we were actually designed this way. Now, if you have your Bible, I want you to find, this is a very difficult passage to find, Genesis 1:1, all right? Spoiler alert, it's the very beginning, OK? Okay, so go to the very beginning of your Bible, and you're going to discover the story of creation. Now, you should know this story. I hope you've heard the story before. God creates everyone. He takes 6 days. He creates all of creation. He looks at it. He says it's good. He creates mankind, and he says it is very good. And then the very next chapters, he's taking a look at humanity, and he sees that man is in the garden doing the job that God has given him to do. And he looks at this guy, and he says, it is not good for man to be alone. Now, why is it not good for man to be alone? Because, you see, we discover that all of us, human beings, have been created in the image of God. That means that all of us contain some of what God is in us, that we reflect who God is as our persons. Not that we are gods, but that we reflect who God is. That means that the things that God is in us. You see, we are to be creative people. All of us can create something. All of us can. We're to be creative because God is creative. We are to discern. We are to look and see things and judge between things and think about things differently because God does that. And it says in the book of the letter of John that God is love. And we are to be loving because, you see, God exists in a perfect community with himself. Now that may sound really weird, but think about this. God is three in one, right? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And all three of them are distinct and separate from each other because they have different roles and different functions, and they do different things, and yet they are all one, and we are to worship them as one because God is one. And so when he creates the world, everything is together in a perfect community, nature and people and God. And they're living this triune community, just as God is. And then he looks and he says, it's not good for the man to be alone. And so he creates a woman to be together with him, and it's perfect. It is exactly right. It is a community working together. And we know what happens. The community is shattered because people believe that they can choose for themselves something other than what God desires, that they can judge for themselves what is right and wrong, that they could be like God on their own power instead of being the image of God. And so it all comes crumbling down. And in the very next chapter, we discover two brothers. Two brothers who are having to live in the new normal. You see, for the very first time, people were separated from God. They couldn't stand in his physical presence and see him. They couldn't interact with him in the way that they used to interact with him. They couldn't be around him. They couldn't be around each other. They couldn't be around the earth in the same way that it was in the beginning. And these two boys grew up not knowing what it was like to have God physically in their presence, to see him walking in the cool of the evening, as it says. Now, these two boys, we learn a lot about them. The first one's name is Cain. And Cain, he learned very early on about soil. He learned very early on about plants and trees and all those things because, you see, his parents taught him everything they knew about plants and trees, and he just really enjoyed that. And he did a good job one day trying to grow something, and it actually grew, and his parents were really excited for him. And so he took to that, and he kept on going. Now, his parents taught him something else. God is very important. We made a mistake, they told him. And we put ourselves first, and so I would like you to put God first. And so they taught him to take the best of what he had and give it to God. Now, I have a couple of kids in my family, and one is six, and whenever she brings something home from school, the very best of what she's made, she always wants to show me, and she's very excited to show me. And quite often, she's very excited to give it to me. I don't know if you've ever experienced that with a child before, where they're just so happy to give you something that they have made. This is the offering that's being made by Cain and then his brother Abel. You see, I imagine Cain finally growing a pear tree. And the very first pears that come off that tree, whether they were good or not, he pulls one off and he looks at it and he's just so excited. He says, I have to go give this to God because God gave me this tree. This is so exciting. And he goes off and he gives his offering. Now his brother wasn't a farmer. His brother's name is Abel. And Abel started discovering that he was really good with animals. And you know what? Cain, who was a farmer, needed somebody who was good with animals, because plowing fields and doing all that stuff by yourself with your bare hands is really hard work. And so the two of them would work together, and they did really great work. They lived in wonderful community with one another. And Abel discovered his ability to raise flocks and do all these things, and he too wanted to bring the best of what he had to God, and he did. Every time, the very first animal that was born, he would bring it and give it as an offering to God. And the two of them would do this year after year, season after season, harvest after harvest. But then one day, I imagine it went like this. Cain grew up some more pears, and he looked at those pears and he thought, you know, I actually need some of these this time around. I need to keep some for myself because, fill in the blank. And so he takes some of them, and he gives some of the good ones to God. But he's like, well, now that offering's looking a little light from what I did last time. Maybe I'll just grab some other stuff and pile it in there. And so he grabs a little bit of wheat, and he grabs a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And it looks like a pretty good basket. And so he gives that to God. And God doesn't say anything about it. And so the very next time it's time for him to give his offering again, he says, well, God didn't really care one way or another. So I would like to eat some of these really nice pears because, my goodness, they look juicy and good. So I'm going to keep all of them this time, and I'm just going to give God something else. And so he gave God something else. God didn't really say much about it, and so time after time, he kept giving and giving, and what he was giving was less and less good. And it says in Scripture that he gave some of what he had. Well, his brother Abel kept giving the best, the very best, the first fruits, the first born of all of his flocks. And it says that God looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but did not look with favor on Cain and his offering. Now, it doesn't tell us how this plays out. It doesn't tell us that if God was speaking directly to them or anything like that, but I imagine what happened was Cain discovered that his fruits kept growing in the exact same manner they were. He wasn't getting any further ahead. He kept working harder and harder and harder to produce the exact same result time and time again. And it seemed like Abel got everything handed to him. Abel's flocks were blessed and were growing, and the work was becoming, yes, more difficult, but he was able to do it for some reason. And God looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but didn't look with favor on Cain and his offering. And so Cain gets angry. Cain saw that God was favoring Abel, and in his heart, got really jealous. And we know what this is like. I've been jealous before, and we know that from a jealous point of view, you start to justify your own anger, don't we? I mean, it happens. I had a girlfriend back in high school, and she lived in a different city from me, and I constantly wrote her letters saying how jealous I was of these other guys who were around her, because I was afraid that they were going to steal her away because she was so beautiful and yada, yada, yada. You know what happened? I drove her away from me with all my jealous questions, right? Because I was coming from a place of anger. I was coming from a place of fear. Now, when we do this against another person, when we start harboring anger in our hearts about somebody else, boy, it's a slippery slope. It starts out pretty simple. You can just yell at somebody in your head. We all do this, I think. You just yell at somebody in your head, and then that person is now just a little bit less. And if you don't address it in your mind, if you don't address that at all, you can keep yelling at them in your head. And then come the sharp comments, right? They start out as simple jokes, but then they get a little bit of an edge to them, and they have a little bit too much to them. And it cuts that person down just a little bit further. And then in your mind, that person's not an equal with you. They're a little bit less and a little bit less and a little bit less. And before you know it, the way you're speaking about that person is all negative all the time. And then after it's all negative all the time, that's when it becomes dangerous. Because after that, they are no longer a person to be respected. They are no longer a person to be around. They are someone to be treated as filth and trash. They are someone to be defeated and overcome. And then all of your conversation starts becoming about me versus them. And they must be defeated because they are evil. This is the path that Cain took in his heart. Because it says that Cain got angry. And as he's speaking to God about this, the Lord says to Cain in verse 6, Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. God gives him a warning. He says, Cain, don't go down that path. Don't go down into anger. Don't treat your brother as someone who is less than you. Don't speak to him poorly. Don't think of him poorly. Do not act against him, because sin is crouching at your door. It's waiting to consume you. It's waiting to drag you away. It's waiting to destroy everything that you have ever accomplished in your life. It's waiting to eat you, Cain. But we know what happens. Cain goes and he lies to his brother, and then he attacks and kills his brother. Boy, he must have been mad. Boy, he must have been mad. Because you see, what Cain wanted, ironically, was the favor of God. And God even came to him and told him exactly what he needed to do to gain the favor of God. And Cain still looked at God and said, nope, I'm going to do it my way, because I know better than you. It's the exact same sin played out in a completely different way. Verse 9, we discover that Cain has destroyed his community. He's destroyed his family. He wanted it all for his own selfish purposes. And the Lord says to Cain, verse 9, where's your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? Verse 10, the Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. And now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it'll no longer yield crops for you. And you will be a restless wanderer on the earth. And Cain said to the Lord, oh, my punishment is more than I can bear. Today you're driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. Now there's some big questions to be asked there, but I want you to think about this for a moment. Cain, in response to God, Cain doesn't say remorse. He doesn't give any regret over what he's done. In fact, what he says to God is, your punishment is too severe. You're coming at me too hard, God. Why? Because he's going to be a restless wanderer. All those relationships that were broken in the very first sin were broken once again for Cain. He is no longer able to work the ground like he did. He once had the favor of God and once was able to do a particular job, but now he can no longer do that. He can't work the ground. The relationship between people and nature was broken all over again. His relationship to his brother and to his family, that community of people around them, between men and women and all that stuff that was broken, once again, and once again it says that he was going to be cast out of the presence of God even further than he was before. All over again. And what is he afraid of? He's afraid of being alone. Because when he's alone, that's when he's going to meet his doom. That's what he's afraid of. Cain's desire was for community. And the question for Cain and the question that comes up for us is the same. Am I cursed to wander the earth alone? Am I all alone in this world? God actually takes that question. He spends the entire rest of Scripture talking about this. Because you see, when we get up to the cross, when we discover Jesus, who goes for all of humanity and says, I want you to no longer be cast out of the presence of God. I want you to be brought back into the presence of God. I want you to stand at his feet and cry out, Abba, which means Father. I want you to be as close to him as people were, as it originally was intended. And no longer will we have this mark on us, this curse on us, but we'll be brought back together in community. And he dies and rises again to show that the power of the curse has no power over us. And the entirety of the New Testament, the entirety of it, is all about how we are to be brought back into community with one another. Philippians 2:4, look at this. We are to not be looking to our own interests, but to be looking to the interests of others. Galatians 6:2, carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. James 1:27, religion that our God, our Father, accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after the orphans and the widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by this world. Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Matthew 25:40, the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. 1 Thessalonians 5:11, therefore encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you have been doing. Finally, John 13, Jesus' own words, a new command I give to you, love one another. Love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Isn't that incredible? What we're being called to in the New Testament is a brand new community, a community that resembles what was there in the beginning, where we are together, where we are in Christ, and he is in us, and all they can see, all people from the outside can see, is Jesus Christ living out amongst each other. Way back in verse 9, the Lord said to Cain, where's your brother Abel? And he responds, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? The entirety of the rest of Scripture and the cross screams out, yes, Cain. Yes, you are. We have a responsibility to one another. It's not just that we were built for community. It's not just that we're built and we want to resist being alone. It's that we have a need built into us to take care of one another. We have a responsibility that is written in Scripture to love one another and to bind each other together, to hold on to each other, because in this world we need each other. We were created for this. We were created to be a community together. In Ecclesiastes 4, we get this gem. And you've maybe read this before. But Solomon, in wondering about the meaning of life, he says, two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But if anyone who falls and has no one to help them, if anyone who falls on their own has no one to help them up, also if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not easily broken. What was it that God said to Cain? He said, be careful, Cain. See, sin is crouching at your door, waiting to devour you. We discover later on in Scripture that the devil prowls around like a lion, waiting to devour those who are far from Christ. Why? Because you see, when you're alone, you can be easily picked off by the enemy. Sin is crouching at your door, waiting to pull you in, but when there's two or more, we can defend ourselves. When there's two or more, we can bear that burden together. When there's two or more, we can celebrate together. When there's two or more, we can play ideas off each other. We can learn from each other. It says in Proverbs, as iron sharpens iron, so does one man sharpen another. We were created to live in community like this. And it's in this community that we discover the grace and the peace, the mercies of the Lord, and we can see it at play in each other's lives. And it's because of this intention that we are striving to do things at this church that will help with community. We've mentioned a few times already about signing up for small groups. And I know this is a very busy church. If you look at our church calendar, there is something going on every week and every month, and there are big events that happen and all these things. We have Sunday school that goes on every single week here at the church. And we have groups of people that meet together to pray and to learn and to study and all those things. And we don't want to add to the noise of the calendar. But we recognize that we need each other. And we need meaningful community. So what these groups are an opportunity to sit and to learn together. To ask questions together. To experience life together. To pray for each other. To celebrate together. This is what these groups are for. And starting on the 22nd, we're going to open up registration for them. And that's such a clinical word. You're going to sign up for them. And the sign-up will be out in the fellowship hall. We're going to have posters up that explain what each group are, when they're going to be meeting, what they're going to be studying. And I would encourage you to sign up for one of them. Now, if you're a regular attender of Sunday school, if you already have a group of people that you've been meeting with for a long time and you're kind of already in a small group. So if you're already connected into this group, into a group here at the church, I would encourage you to just leave that off your calendar because we don't need one more thing to attend. Nobody needs another thing to be going to. But if you are not connected with anybody, if you don't have a group that you belong to, if you don't have some people here at the church that you know, if you're looking for that kind of community, this is particularly for you. If you're new to the church, if you've been coming to the church for a long time but look around and say, I don't have a meaningful connection with a single person in this room, these are the groups for you. This is time for you. Why don't we just take a moment and let's pray. And during this prayer, I'm going to stop in the middle and I'm going to give you the opportunity to pray silently. And I would like you to pray for each other. Pray for the people in your row. Pray for the people sitting around you. You may not know their name. You may not know who they are. But all of us are in need of this kind of connection, as we've seen in Scripture this morning. And so during this prayer, I would like you to pray specifically for the people in your area. Let's pray. Lord and Father, again, we want to thank you for who you are. God, you've called to us and asked us to be your people. You have called to us and asked us to come closer to you, to stay in you, to remain in you. And Lord, as we strive to do that, as we strive to learn exactly how we are to behave and exactly how we are to live this life you've called us to, Lord, you've asked us to do that together. And so, Father, I pray that you give us the courage to ask good questions. Lord, I pray that you give us the courage to develop new relationships. God, I pray that you give us the courage to sign up for small groups. Because, Lord, each and every one of us needs your help. Each and every one of us needs to know you in a deeper and more meaningful way. And, Lord, all of us are searching for you. And right now, Father, I just ask that you hear our prayers. John chapter 13, he said, a new command I give to you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Lord, it's this love that we ask for. It's this love that we pray that we can share. And Father, I pray that you open our eyes and open our hearts to each other. Father, may this church follow you. May we love you even more every day. It's in Jesus' name we pray.